about people that sing sacred music. And I checked with our resident expert, and indeed she has heard of the term Schola Cantorum. And you would describe that as school of singing. But what this little piece that I found about the school of singing or Schola Cantorum said is at its root in the Latin, rather than school, it was about having fun and being joyful. Now, wouldn't it be nice if at its core, all of our learning and academic pursuits could be joyful and all about fun? And I think it's important that, especially in a faith community, that we create a place for our younger friends where they can feel like they're in a school of joy, a school of fun, a school of love. There'll be plenty of opportunities for them in their academic pursuits to have challenges, to get less than perfect grades. But I don't believe that that is what church, particularly the Church of Christ, set us out to be. You only need to look at the greatest commandment that we heard today. Love your Lord, your God, with all your heart and soul and mind. And there is a second like it. Love your neighbor. It is not grade your neighbor's papers. It is not judge your neighbor. It is not telling them to do better that Jesus says we are to do. He is telling us to love our neighbor. And especially, I think that applies to our younger friends that face many, many challenges. And the church should be the place where they feel loved, whether they go on and get a PhD, or whether they struggle to find a blue-collar job or just make a living. This is the place where they should feel loved, and we all should feel loved. I remember particularly the church I served some years ago. There was a young lady that came every Sunday with her mom. She was a senior at the local high school. And that church gave out scholarships. And it so happened that she did not receive a scholarship. This was a small rural church, and she was the only high school senior that was there in attendance every week. But another person was more involved in school activities and had a higher GPA. So this girl, even though she was very dedicated to worship, did not get the church scholarship. So happened, fast forwarding about a year, and when I was a driver to the local ambulance service, there was a call to her residence, and she had overdosed on some narcotics. And thankfully, she was okay. And I believe that she did recover from that, and as far as I know, she's doing all right. But I often wonder to myself, what if she had been loved a little bit more by the church community? I don't think that she had an issue with drugs just because the church did not give her a scholarship. So hear me on that. But I wonder, if she had been a little bit more loved, if she had felt a certain closeness in church community rather than being rejected because her GPA wasn't high enough, would it have made a difference? So in our call to worship today, we heard part of how God made out when he went up for tenure. And this was a tongue-in-cheek thing from Oregon State University, where God was applying for tenure in the School of Business. And here's the complete reasons they gave for why God did not receive tenure. He had only one major publication. It was in Hebrew, and it wasn't published in a preferred journal. Some expressed doubt that he'd even written it himself, thinking it was a fantasy book. Yes, he created the universe, but what had God done since? He was reluctant to cooperate with other deities. The scientific community had trouble replicating his work. He didn't get prior permission from the ethics board to work with human subjects. One experiment failed, and he tried to cover it up by drowning the subjects. He rarely came to class. Many students had to learn just by reading his book. According to some, his son taught his class. He expelled his first two students when they learned too much. There are only 10 requirements, and we're still messing them up. And his office hours were infrequent and often held on a mountaintop. No, God just does things differently than sometimes the academic world or the business world or the corporate world, or dare I say, even the church world says he should do them or she should do them. Jesus is calling us to do one thing, one greatest commandment, to love. To love God and to love our neighbors, regardless of where we stand in our academic pursuits, regardless of how big our pensions are, regardless of what car we drive, how many houses we have, whether we have a PhD or whether we have a GED, God is calling us to love. Now, I admit at times I fall into the ways of the world. People say, what did you do? What do you do? Say, I'm a retired CPA and a pastor. Because that's just what the world has conditioned many of us to do. And admittedly, I'm a little proud of the fact that I have two professional accreditations as a certified public accountant and a pastor. But it really doesn't matter to God one iota. What Christ says I need to do is to love God and love neighbors. So if I was a little better, when people say, what do? I would say, I'm a follower of Jesus, and I'm into that loving God and loving neighbor business. Who knows? Maybe it's something for us all to think about, and maybe more of those neighbors will come and join us. Couple stories to share with you. This is one of Ronald Reagan's favorite jokes. It goes like this. There was a certain little boy who reached school age. His mother had worked hard to make him enthusiastic about the idea of school, bought him new clothes, told him that the other children he would meet, got him excited about the projects he would encounter on his first day. And he came home with excellent reports of what school was like. Well, the next morning, his mother went to his bedroom and said, he had to get up. And he said, what for? And she said, you got to go to school. And he said, I thought I'd done that yesterday. Sometimes it can be challenging to keep hanging in there at work or in school. But again, if we have love of one another, if we have love of God, often that's the thing at our core that can empower us to keep going. There's nothing wrong with achieving what we can achieve and becoming all that we can be, but at our core, we are called to love. And I'll close with this example from Irma Bombach. especially powerful meeting for me to quote Werner von Beck, because the first Methodist preacher I ever knew, William Rowe Sr., became quite fond of quoting Werner von Beck from the pulpit. Herman's story goes like this. And this is a view of a boy named Donald and his views on education. And she wrote, "My name is Donald, and I don't know anything. I have new underwear and a loose tooth, and I didn't sleep last night because I'm worried about school. What if a bell rings and a man yells, 'Where do you belong?' And I don't know. What if the trays in the cafeteria are too tall for me to reach? What if my loose tooth comes out when we have our heads down and we're supposed to be quiet? Am I supposed to bleed quietly? What if I splash water on my name tag and my name disappears and no one knows who I am?" End of quote. Probably we've all faced anxieties in pursuit of higher education, school, the workplace, maybe even occasionally in the church. You wonder, does anyone really care? Well, if we do what Jesus calls us to do at our best, we know that God cares, and we should know that others care, as we are called to love God and to love neighbor. Let us pray.